So we will start one more session of the Logical University's webinar today. And Razvan Diaconescu is the chair of the session. Please, Razvan.
Well, thank you very much. So I'm really, really very honored to chair this session for several reasons. And I think one of the reasons is, I will not talk much about this, but I have to say this. These are all friends of mine, this group from Lisbon. Actually, I think I met them first in early 90s, maybe 1990, in the ISCOR meetings, when I was student of Professor Gogan. And since then, I think I developed a friendship with this group, with especially with Professor, late Professor Amilcar. And I developed a very strong appreciation for his work and this, and also, and I want to emphasize this, for his human side. He was always very friendly, very a very pleasant person to be with, which I would say is not necessarily very often in scientific circles. I want to say that I'm very happy to see that, very, very happy to see that his legacy continues vigorously today. This makes me very happy, and it's a great honor for me to be present and chair this session. So I think there will be two events in this session. I think in the first part, Professor Paul Mateusz will present us his group on quantum and security. And then Professor Cristian Cernadas and João Rasga will present us their book published in Studies of Universal Logic book series. So please, Paolo, you can start.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Razvan. I remember also to talk with you and many of the people here when I was a student, and this is our old memories, of course. And let me just start that the group is not mine. I coordinate it, which is not the same thing as owning a group. That's a different thing, right? So that's a completely different spirit of that. For the moment, I coordinate it because I have connections with where we are. Let me start by sharing the web page. I was actually refreshing a bit the web page. That was a bit, we have actually to work a bit on keeping it on date. So you can see that our faces are a bit more or less the same, but not exactly, since 2006. The group has a strange name, Security and Quantum Information Group for a Group to Be with Logicians, as you might find it exotic or not. So the group was originally came from the Center of Logic and Computation that Amilcar was created and it was very bureaucratic to manage centers in Portugal. So it's really a pain. So what we wanted at the time and discussed was, can we join a large group that the bureaucracy is exactly the same, where it makes sense for logicians to be and to contribute? That was the idea in 2006. And Amilcar, that had a huge and strong connection in IST, suggested we join a telecommunication institute, which I'm going to give just an idea. So this is a very large research lab full of engineers, people from physics, people from chemistry, and some mathematicians. And we had to convince that we are actually useful to be there. And I think we are. We have developed a huge collaboration with them in several senses. Would be stronger. The good point of being in a lab is that they are very, you know, grant oriented, and so they have access to a lot of money. So we live in kind of some comfortable place in terms of funding, as far as I want. Let me just show you how we moved. So Amilcar joined, and since we had to have some kind of application scenario for our research in maths, we choose the topic that in 2006 was not hot, but now it's completely hot. So now we have so much money coming from this topic because we're the first group in Portugal to come up, that was quantum information and security. So security was already very hot at that time because we have moved on using, you know, probabilistic logics and quantum logics and areas on this area. And we wanted to do formal verification on of protocols and of security protocols on that area. And this is how we introduced ourselves to the research lab. So IT is gigantic. Let me show you, it's a big research lab. This is actually the former president that is the chief of the academic sciences in Portugal. And he has five areas. Let me just go very briefly. We are in the basic science and enabled technologies, right? And if we go here to basic science and enabled technologies, you see that we have here something that they put logic and computation, right? So we have people from optimization, from NFS and other areas of maths, usually connected, so also in coding and things like that. And the areas are these, and we are organizing research clusters, and our cluster is applied mathematics, right? So, and actually I was elected this year the coordinator also of that cluster on applied mathematics in IT. So this is a gigantic center that has like 15 million euros funding per year. And we have access to projects, to local projects and promoting these things. So we have trying to also put some, so now we are going to apply for internal project on using formal methods on verifying distributed networks and things like that. The group, since has to be also strong on security and quantum information, the Mac has a problem, is that everything rings. When everything rings. So the group is kind of hybrid. So we have people from logic, we have people from physics, which essentially are know a lot of maths, but know zero from logic. It's very curious. So they are very curious about logic. And we also have people from computer science, more on security and so on. So to understand who are the people more connected to logic, you just can go here and check SLC, which is a section for logic and computation. And you can see that we have around, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 people more on logic. People on there are more on computer science, also with some aspects on formal verification. And then we have the remaining are physicists that work on quantum information theory. And you can go around. We have, we have students. We have several PhD students. And the work has been on that area. So some of these are a bit outdated. So the area of the group focus on this. So on logic, which is from the foundations to the application. So it doesn't have to be applied logic. So they accept clearly that we do completely foundational work on logic. Work on complexity, quantum information, and security, and the current funding that we have. I actually was so we come from evil, like European Defense Fund and things like that, to the good thing that is just pure research funding here. So we have also past projects on the area and so on and so on. I think this is more or less. So we have been working together and hosted people from logic. The relationship in IT is very good. We also belong to the Department of Mathematics, of course. And the group essentially is very stable. So Milcar also had a strong sense of connection with applications, which we try to continue. On this sense, but also not forgetting that we are mathematicians at the end of the day and we have to do foundational work. Okay, so I think we are lucky in a sense because we are in a setting that allows us to grow because we have access to funding and so on. On the other hand, I mean, of course, engineers find us a bit strange. We must say that they find us a bit strange. I cannot understand what we do some of the time. So we have to make bridges. There's an effort on that thing. But on the other hand, I have made many projects with them and with many papers with them on verifying that certain protocols that were open that can terminate things that were open, and they want to prove that they always terminate things like that that they cannot do, where the back end of a logician can go. So this is kind of the group. In the areas of quantum, we have physicists, the two foundations. By the way, physicists are very, they study a lot of maths, but don't know nothing about logic. And they are really, really fond of Gödel and Copernicus theorem and all these things. It's something that they are always coming to. For them, this is something that they don't know and they want to understand. And actually, in the PhD courses that we are having, we have a lot of students from physics that want to get a bit of knowledge on logic and computability. So logic is becoming kind of a new thing, especially because I think physics is a bit stuck and they have to go somewhere. And actually the Church-Markov-Turing postulate is kind of a physical postulate that you can only compute these kind of things and so on. And this has created a lot of hip on the area of logic and computation outside of maths. So this is kind of the presentation of the group. This is my 10 minutes, I think. If you have any questions to ask about how this works and how we go. And of course, Cristina and João are here from the beginning. They were also founders. Emilcar was the first coordinator. Then he passed to me because engineers tend to be a bit chaotic and Emilcar didn't like chaos. This was one of the things. And the engineers are very chaotic. They want things in the day before, the day after. They are really crazy in a sense. And people have to kind of either ignore or have kind of a support for these kind of things. And I was kind of the person that keep doing the thing. So this is more the group is not owned by me. I just coordinate it and hopefully it's going to rotate to other people. So essentially this is what I wanted to say. And if you had questions, I would like to answer anything about the group and as you go. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Paulo. And we look forward to the questions.
Yes, if anybody has questions about our group of logicians working with engineers, the work does, I can help on that.
Nobody questions, but I can't have a question. So how is it possible to do you have PhD students in this group?
Yes, these are all PhD.
I mean PhD students, not of the PhD students should be of University of Lisbon or
the they are all Institute. From university. Oh, okay, so the thing, so
not well, from the Institute.
Maybe I should have presented this. So in Portugal we are a bit schizophrenic in how we work. So we have two affiliations. One is where we teach, that pays our wage, and then another affiliation is our research affiliation. This is a bit exotic. For instance, when we run for projects, because if you run two projects, I will run with University of Cambridge, for instance, and I cannot go with University of Lisbon. I have to go with IT or a research center in Portugal. So this is how we work. So university in Portugal gives us our wage, And the research center is where we do our research. And all the funding associated with the research is done. Kind of in RIA style in France, but not exactly the same. So we have a bipolar vision of the thing. So the students are granted, and since this is PhD students are associated to research, they belong to the research institute. But only universities can give grades. So they actually, in this case, all the students that are here are from our university, but it could be the case that, for instance, they were in, we have here people from other places, like Daniel Graça, that is from Algarve. He could have a student from Algarve, and he will be part of this research team as well. So this is not just geographically located. So for instance, Daniel is in Algarve. And we have, in the past, people from Oporto in our group, that then they generate their own group. And so from our group, many groups have appeared after. So we have created from this original group from center, at least three groups were then appeared. So we have been a
nest.
a nest of groups that then go out and continue their own things. Not necessarily in logic, actually. In logic, I think it's not the case, but for instance, in security, in quantum, other people have moved out of this area. So this is how it works. So these students here are all PhD students of us that are in our university because the majority of people is in this university. So the only person in our group that is not on this university is this person and this person. Right, so this is the case. So this is from physics, and this is from our University of Algarve, and this is from another institute that is another university, not in the University of Lisbon. More questions. So Razvan, this is how we work here in Portugal. So before, we were a center that had some more or less the same people with a group of Amilcar, and we have to do the same, essentially the same bureaucracy of a research lab that has like 200, 300 people and has money of 10 million, 12 million, 15 million euro. So they have functionaries to deal with that. So this is unbearable for a small group in Portugal. So people have to associate. We could associate with other mathematicians, but we found that we were better appreciated, or let's say, I think we had more success of giving something new to people. And you see, if you have 10 million, 100,000 is nothing. And they will give us, I have several projects, internal projects, each of them with 100,000. They just gave the 100,000 to see what happens. And this is a call that is competitive, evaluated by I didn't put these projects here, but you can see the projects in other places. So it's important that they only fund projects if the projects have engineers together with them. So you can go here, and I have a page here as well that they organize. So let me find my page. You can put for everybody here their page, right? And here is my page. Oops, I don't know why this happens. So I see, I don't know. So they are showing, I don't know. Let's open the page. So this is, it opens Record. I don't see Record very often, except when Portugal plays. But okay, so let's see the projects that I have. So some of these projects, like this one here, are projects that are given internally by them from this money. For instance, this Quest project. This is a project, there is a funding that they probably don't do, they say FCT, but this is from the 10 million people, and they have to have engineering people there, and they have Nicola and things like that. So this is how it works. So it's very nice because you have all these, I cannot remove this now. Okay, I don't use Safari that often. So it's very nice because we have access to these projects, internal projects, as far as they make sense to collaborate with engineers. So it has to be kind of applied. If you want to say, look, I want to study some, firing of these logics without any connections to whatever they are doing, they will not give money to the prize. But if you are saying, no, firing of logics can solve this issue that you have here, or some combination of logics, or studying the decidability of these, can help, for instance, analyze, for instance, distributed or logic, something like that, can check the verification of some distributed network protocol that they have, then they will find. So this is how it works. And I think it's an interesting scenario. It's competitive because these projects are evaluated by European Union, but it's much less competitive than in Portugal, in maths, there are two projects per year, in all Portugal. So it's very hard that they go to logic, because logic is not the most, fancy area in maths, let us say. So geometry, there is other areas, mathematical physics and things like that, that are more, fields oriented. And so it's complicated to get money on that area. So, I mean, it's not just money. This is also that they give us the liberty to do what we want. That's also very important. So we can still be... If we don't spend money, they also don't have problems. If you want to go to a place, I mean, as far as we publish papers, they give us always some minimum amount of money, of course, for us to travel or to do things. This is how it works. So it's not very normal. Some people don't like it. They say we should be in maths. I've talked with people, why are we not with maths people and so on. But as far as I go, I like the involvement. It also connects us. We are in an engineering university. And it also gives us feedback with engineers, what are their problems, and we have contact with them. Otherwise, we are in our own labs doing our own, in our own office doing our own things, and it might be a bit. And I mean, the connections with computer science and the electrical engineer and so on exists always in the past, so why don't they should not continue? I mean, if there were no logicians, there were no computer science. So this is it. We are the founders of the end.
So other questions? If there are no other questions, I still have one small question, but different nature, more technical. This is because of my ignorance. So maybe everybody knows the answer, but since I'm here, why not? So there is this great hype all over the world about quantum computing. So you see, for example, a lot of courses a lot of universities, top universities like MIT or something, they teach such kind of thing even in mathematics. They teach. I saw a course in the mathematics faculty of quantum computing. So what is the relationship between quantum logic and quantum computation? So how big role place quantum logic in this paradigm of quantum computation?
Okay, so that is an interesting question. I will try to answer as best as possible. So there are two points here. So you want to understand the role of logic in quantum computation. So, but I mean, the role of logic in computation is more or less obvious, right? Because
computation
came out of logic, right? So there are, I mean, you can consider logic. You see, when you talk logic to electrical engineers, they think about circuit logic, CMOS logic, which are the gates that you are going to use, right? And are you going to use AND or XOR gates? So when you talk about logic to electrical engineers, they don't think about first order logic. They think about the logic of the gates that you are going to have. And actually, quantum computing is at the level, one of them, for instance, IBM, uses only logic gate-based programming, which is actually connected with logic because you generate kind of a circuit, but now it's instead of a Boolean circuit, you are generating a Boolean quantum circuit, right? It's not quantum or called just a quantum circuit. So all extending all these results on, Boolean circuits and that's one way. There are other aspects. For instance, you want to prove that protocols actually work, you can do it. So you have done logics to reason about, classical logics, classical programs and classical computation, and you want to generalize. But one thing that is important is that people usually talk about quantum logic. They think about Birkhoff and von Neumann logic. I don't know if that's the case that you're talking. If you are talking about quantum and von Neumann and Birkhoff and von Neumann quantum logic, I don't think that there is much there, honestly, because they were not actually thinking about, there is something, but they were not thinking about quantum computing at the time. So there are some connections there, but it's not really a deep one. For instance, the paper I have with Milkar, the completeness of exhaustion is quantum logic is actually about the logic to reason about quantum circuits, and we show. I mean, after we show that it's decidable, everything is algebraic at the end, so we can actually check if the circuit computes whatever and what is the complexity associated to that, and so there's a lot of work for logicians to do that. I mean, that's quantum programming language. And I think the right question to do is, are there going to be quantum computers? Which, since we are being recorded, I'm not going to say an answer for that, but privately I can give you an answer, my opinion. But this has been a huge thing. There's a huge funding on the quantum thing. So most of the projects that we have here actually are, you have the word quantum there, right? Quantum prime number generation, open quantum key distribution, quantum distributed oblivion, quantum data mining. This is also as quantum, things like that. And I don't know who is actually writing, but I don't think it's myself. So I mean, these logicians for sure have to do something with quantum. And there's also another thing that is, I'm probably talking too much because I suppose only just to present 10 minutes, but since Razvan is pushing from to me, there's another issue is that when you limit the power of what a physical world can do, right, independent of quantum and so on, so you, because physicists don't understand why are we limited to the Turing, to a Turing machine computation level and the complexity to the fastness of a quantum computer. And this is a foundational problem in physics because it doesn't stem out of the trivially out of thermodynamics or all the you know quantum mechanics conjectures. So why are we, I mean, according to quantum mechanics, you can compute a non-computable function, right? And this is a foundational issue. That's why they want to study, because they want to understand where is the limitation, because the Turing, the physical Turing Church Markov, Church Turing postulate that you can only compute this is a physical result. So it's actually a physical postulate. And people from quantum are really interested to know the limitations of the physical world to compute things. And this is a logical problem. I mean, you could grow a bit out, but it stems from logic, from symbolism. What can we do? What is a machine? And things like that. I think I talked too much, but I hope I answer Razvan.
Yeah, of course, this is the beginning of the answer, yes.
Otherwise, I will be talking here all an hour.
I don't study in depth, you know, such kind of things to get a proper understanding. But I think it's a good start for me.
Okay. I think you while looking into it.
I would like to add something about the quantum front, because actually, João Rasga and myself finished a paper that Amilcar was not able to finish because of the reasons you know about, which is about quantum logic. And it's basically about observables and so forth. And we did that also in collaboration with physicists. But we did not make the connection with quantum circuits and so forth. Exactly. And actually there is an open problem there, which is related that we can't cope with, for example, certain facts that are important to physicists, like position and momentum, because mm-hmm. then you have to deal with partial things and so forth. So there is still something to do there. Okay, mm-hmm. It's very difficult because the language of the physicists is basically different from your own. And when you read books written by physicists, again, it's a problem. Okay, so it's very difficult. And to talk with them is also different because we want to do general things, and they are always reporting particular cases. So what is about this and that? And we don't know because we don't know the physical phenomena. So it's difficult, but it's something that I would like to return because it's interesting. And actually the logic that we developed is not in the same way as the Birkhoff and von Neumann, because it's an extension of a propositional logic. So it's a bit different, okay? But still we have things to do there, but it's very difficult. It took us a lot of time, right? And a lot of effort. And that was the first time that I said to João, we cannot do this. We cannot prove the completeness of this logic. Mm-hmm. But then in the end, we managed to do so. So it was a victory in the end.
Yeah, there are really open questions in physics on the foundations, and I think logic can help them. Yeah, so these observers and things like that. Okay,
so I would be interested to get your paper.
So I can send it to you or
point. Yeah, please send it to me.
Okay.
Okay, I will stop sharing now. I think it's time.
Anyway, thank you very much for presentation. Perhaps if there are no other questions about this, then we can move to the second leg of this session, which is a presentation of a book by professors Cristian Cernada and João Rasga, published in Studies of Universal Logic book series. I think one of the is my favorite book series, not because I'm
an author there,
board, but I like this idea of universal logic very, very much. So it's one of the greatest ideas in science in the past years. So please start your presentation.
Which one is it? Is this one? Let me just enter the full screen.
Okay. So I will start the presentation. I would like to start by thanking Jean-Yves by the invitation to present our recent book. The book is co-authored by me and by Christina. And just a moment. Okay. And when writing the book, let me start by doing some acknowledgements. We had many conversations and discussions with colleagues, and we'd like to emphasize some of them, namely Walter and Amilcar, for so many and deep discussions on logic that helped us in writing the book. So the book was also supported by Instituto de Telecomunicações, namely by the Security and Quantum Information Group. So we like also to acknowledge that, and by the Fundação para a Ciência e Tecnologia. So the main aim of the book was to provide a self-contained introduction to decidability of first order theories and their combination. So in the book we provide several techniques, results, and methods that can be used to show that the first order theory has decidability, enjoys decidability, or analyze that from the point of view of combination, when combining theories with which are decidable, what kind of results can we obtain? And the book intends to be self-contained, so we try to provide the basic notions, definitions, concepts, so that it can be read by and understood by people from mathematics, computer science, and philosophy. It is intended for graduate students and researchers. And this is the goal of the book. Just to give you a flavor, a gist of the book. So first order theory over a signature sigma is a set of first order formulas closed under the first order consequence relation. And a theory, we consider a theory is decidable whenever its characteristic map is computable. So whenever there is an algorithm that can decide whether or not a given formula is in the set, in the theory, in this case. Or since the theory is closed under consequence, it is the same as asking if it is a consequence of the theory or not. Some of the theories that we consider, among of the theories that we consider in the book, we consider the theory of real closed ordered fields, which is a theory based on the signature composed of the constants 0 and 1, and operations minus, plus, times, and the predicates equality and congruence and less than. The theory is generated by these axioms. Okay, it is a well-known theory in this field, in this area. So in the book, we show that it is decidable. We have the results that prove that go back to the work of Tarski. And we, among the others, we also consider, for instance, a simpler theory for the natural numbers, for instance, with only the zero and successor operator, and with this and generated by these very simple axioms. And we, in the book, it is also shown that this theory is decidable using the results there. And we also consider, for instance, the combination of this theory, of these theories, what kind of preservation results can we have about decidability? What's the impact of combining these theories in terms of decidability? There are some results in the literature that that are in the book that I speak a little bit more detailed later. So there are other books that tackle this topic of decidability of first order theories. More theoretical ones are the last three books in the area of model theory, in which there are some results about decidability of first order theories. The first book of Bradley and Mana analyzes the decidability of several concrete theories, but it is a very concrete book. It is not, in a certain sense, very universal. It deals with the concrete theories and analyzes them. And then there is this book of Bazou, Polak, and Roy for the specific theory of real closed order fields, in which there are a lot of algorithms that are studied over this theory. These are some of the books that tackle this issue of decidability of first order theories. In what aspects are our book different from these ones? And are in what aspects that this book contributes to, that they have aspects that are not in the others? We try to put in this book, results that are fragmented across several books. So we put together in this book the results, either theoretical or practical, that concern the decidability of first order theories. So we try to put together in this book all the relevant results that in this area. Then we try to consider the results not for particular first order theories, but try to present them in all its generality. So we, as the name of the series says, we try to be universal in the results that we present. We try to present the results as more universal as possible, and then try to instantiate them to the concrete theories that we consider to illustrate them. Which is not the case, for instance, in some of the books that I presented before. Some of the books have results for this theory, for that theory. In our book, we try to be as more general as possible. And then our book does not require a deep knowledge on certain mathematical fields like algebra and geometry that other books in the area require. For instance, the books on model theory that I mentioned before, we think that they require some deep knowledge on algebra and geometry, and we try to avoid that and try to write a book that is self-contained. So we try to introduce all the relevant notions, results that could be relevant, that are needed to understand these results on decidability. Then another different aspect from the other books in the literature is that we also try to provide a way to reason about the theories that we are interested in. So among the methods of reasoning, we have several deductive calculus, and among the deductive calculus that we could use, we choose to use the Gensen calculus because we think that is deductive calculus well suited for doing proofs, for doing derivations, for understanding the for reasoning about a theory. And since we had to work with, since we work with Gensian calculus, we decided also to prove properties of the calculus that would be useful when reasoning about theory. So cut elimination, for instance, Kreg interpolation, we think that are properties that could be useful. Besides this, we also have another method that is not present in the other books in the area, which is we consider the combination of theories. And we studied impact of combining theories in terms of decidability. I think these are some aspects that are not present in the other books in the literature, and that differentiates our book. The book has these chapters, and as you see, we try to focus on the general results, on general properties, and then instantiate to concrete cases of concrete theories. Okay, so now I will try to speak a little bit about more about the contents of the book. Namely, in the book we study, among the other, these theories that you see here. And it starts by, since we intend to write a book that is self-contained, it starts by presenting the basics of first-order logic. First chapter is dedicated to introducing first-order logic. So we start by introducing notions like signature, language, interpretation structures, satisfaction, implement relation, some lemmas and some theorems that are relevant for the results on decidability that we intend to prove, show. And then we need to introduce also some relevant model theoretic notions like embedding, isomorphism. So notions that intend to relate into interpretation structures and to establish relationships between the interpretation structures. And we analyzed this and we introduced these notions and we studied its impact on preservation of and reflection of satisfaction and other notions. Now I will give the Cristina will present the chapters in alternation.
Okay, so I will talk about our second chapter. It's about Gensian calculus. So the idea is that you have an axiomatization of a theory and somehow you want to reason about that axiomatization. And we arrive to the conclusion that Gensian calculus is easier to use than, for example, a Hilbert-style calculus. So we provide the notion of derivation of a sequence from a set of sequences, and how we can derive in the Gensian calculus a formula from a set of formulas. Then we go on presenting the soundness of the calculus. So whenever you prove something, a formula using a Gensian calculus from a set of formulas, this means semantically that phi will be entailed by the set of formulas. We also study the completeness of the calculus, which is the other way around. So if a formula is entailed by a set, then the formula can be derived in the Gensian calculus from the set. And we use the Indica technique for proving this completeness. And since we allow the use of cut elimination in the derivations that we do, we then make some reflections about cut elimination, namely proving the cut elimination theorem. We also prove the Kreg interpolation because we believe it's an opportunity for talking about Kreg. And we believe that this is a good start when students do not know anything about logic because they start liking the Gensian calculus and so forth. And so it's a good way to start and to go on to deeper topics, I would say.
Thank So the next chapter is about decidability results on first order theories, and so we start by relating decidability with computable quantifier elimination, and show that it is possible to prove that a theory is decidable when we prove that it has quantifier elimination that is computable, and its quantifier-free fragment, is closed quantifier-free fragment is decidable. Then we also show that decidability can be established via reduction, by reducing. So if you are interested in proving that a theory is decidable, and if we can reduce it to other theory that is decidable, then the decidability result is reflected to the original theory. And we use this result, for instance, in the book, to show that the theory the Euclidean geometry, first order theory introduced by Tarski, proposed by Tarski, is decidable by reducing to the theory of real closed order fields. Then we show some results on the use of completeness to establish decidability. And since completeness is very important to in this topic of as a sufficient condition for decidability, we analyze completeness more deeply, and we relate completeness with quantifier elimination, and we also establish the Clausewogt categoricity theorem, and relate also completeness with categoricity. And all this we try to illustrate. First, we try to prove the general results, and then we try to illustrate with concrete examples of first order theories to which they apply along the way.
Okay, now I would like to concentrate on quantifier elimination, because as you saw before, in sufficient conditions for decidability, it's often to find that quantifier elimination is needed. So I would say that we give two perspectives of quantifier elimination, one which we called constructive approach. So what does it mean? It means that for you to have quantifier elimination, you should provide for each formula a quantifier-free formula with the same set of free variables. And you should be able to prove that they are equivalent from the point of view of theta, meaning that theta derives the equivalence of the formula and the quantifier-free counterpart. So the constructive approach is to provide techniques in which you can give for a certain formula what is the quantifier-free formula that will be equivalent to it from the point of view of the theory you are taking. So that's one point. Of course, you have a result that shows to you that you do not need to look into every possible first order formula. You just have to concentrate on existential formulas that then have a quantifier-free formula. And with that, you can prove the general property about quantifier elimination. Then we concentrate on models. And here, what we have is that we recognize that actually you have a class of models, which is the class of models of theta, of the theory. And it is also relevant to consider the class of models, not of theta, but of a subset of theta, which is theta for all. And what is theta for all is the set of all formulas that you have in the theory, which are closed and which have several universal quantifiers in the beginning and then a quantifier-free formula. So in the end, you have two classes of formulas. And basically what you have here about algebraically problem models have to do with that. So please observe that once you have a model for theta, you also have a model for theta for all, but it's not the other way around. So algebraically prime models means that you are able to provide for each model in theta for all, a model for theta. And then you have to verify that there is a kind of universal property if you think in categorical terms. And exists embeddings have to do with the preservation and reflection of local satisfiability for some existential formulas where you have an existential quantifier and then again a quantifier-free formula. And that led us to reason a little bit about this thing, because if you are somehow If you know something about category theory, of course you say, but this has some relationship with category theory. Of course it does, but it is not a so deep concept, because sometimes you do not need to work with functors and so forth, but in the end, it's something that mimics adjunctions. And in certain cases, actually, you have adjunctions between the category of models for theta and the category of models for theta for all. So this is interesting. Another thing that we also tackle is when you have to, when you can prove the property of having algebraically prime models via iteration. What does it mean? In broad terms, is the following. So instead of providing a map from the models of theta to the models of theta for all, you can do this by iteration. So that means that you start by proving that you can evolve from a model of theta for all to another model of theta for all, in which you somehow prove more things. Because, for example, if you look into the examples that João gave for the successor theory and also the real closed, or the real closed fields, you see that all the axioms are typically several universal quantifiers and then a quantifier-free formula. But then you have something which does not have to do with that. For example, when you are proving that when you require in fields that there will be a multiplicative inverse for all the numbers, let's say, different from zero, you see that you have existential quantifiers. So, of course, when you have a model for theta for all, that means that it is possible that that axiom is not satisfied. But when you do this thing in steps, so after the first iteration, you already satisfy the existential formulas that you have. But then you have to iterate once again and so forth. And in the end, it can be proved that you arrive to a point where from a model for theta for all, you get a model for theta. Okay, and we prove that in the book as well. And we illustrate this for the successor theory because it's simple and the people can see how this works.
Okay, so the next chapter is about the combination of first order theories and the impact on decidability of combining first order theories. So this is, there is not, as far as we know, a general result that guarantees the preservation of decidability for all the theory. So we concentrate on a well-known result, and that is about preservation of satisfiability by Nelson and Open when combining theories. And we present it, we rephrase it in terms of decidability, because in the literature, this result, this technique of preserving decidability is not of preserving satisfiability / decidability was never presented before in terms of decidability. Was Nelson Open technique was only presented in terms of satisfiability. In this book, we present, as far as we know, we present it in terms of decidability. And let me just start that there are several techniques for combining logics, but for theories, combinational theories, the technique that we consider is the union of the theory, or union of the axioms, is a theory generated by the union of the axioms of the given theories. So this is the combination that we consider of theories. And and so we go back to the more general result that we have in this area, which was proven by Nelson and Open in terms of satisfiability, and proved it in terms of decidability. And we were able to show that when the given theories do only share equality and are stably infinite, in the sense that if there is a model of the theory that satisfies a formula, then there is an infinite model that satisfies that formula, then if the given theories has a decidable quantifier-free fragment, then the theory that results from the combination of those theories also has a decidable quantifier-free fragment. So this, we rephrase it, we prove this technique, this method of Nassen open in terms of decidability, and we illustrate these results precisely by studying the combination of the successor theory with the successor theory that I presented before, with the real closed ordered field, by renaming the only constant that they have in common, that is the zero. We have to rename it in one of the theories to a different name. But after this renaming, we could consider the theory that results from the combination of those theories, so that it allows to reason about natural numbers and to reason about the reals simultaneously, but without interaction. And we were able to illustrate these results with that combination.
So we end the book with a modicum on computability theory, because as you saw before, computability is essential when we talk about decidability. And so, of course, we had to choose a computational model, and we decided to use an abstract high-level programming language so that we could use as universe of work the set of first-order formulas. So we emphasize on the notion of computable function and computable map, decidable set and also listable of computably enumerable sets. And we also provide some properties about decidable and listable sets. Please observe that the students that of mass of our department, I will talk about that furthermore later on, will have a further course on computability theory. So this is just a modicum for them to understand better the concepts. Okay, so now we have been using, we have been giving a course on this subject in our master on mathematics and applications for almost 10 years. And the book is an outgrowth of that. So you may ask, what kind of students do we have? We have students from the MSc degree in math and applications, also a few from physics, and two or three from economics. So the first question that maybe you are asking is, why not people from computer science? In our institution, we have an engineering degree in informatics. And it is in informatics. I wouldn't say that it is in computer science. And when they are doing their MSc, of course, they have a lot of courses, specific ones in which they have lots of projects. So they have a lot of work. And of course, they don't have the patience and the time to dedicate to a course like this one. So that's the justification that I can give to that. Okay, so thank you for your attention and time. And let me finish by telling you something, which is we have the impression that not our colleagues, of course, those don't like logic and like, but I would say that students have some interest in logic. And that comes because somehow they are curious about what is formal, what is symbolic, and so forth. But mainly they are interested in global incompleteness theorems. That's for sure. And also sometimes they heard about Hilbert's program, but basically the Gödel's incompleteness theorems. And you may ask, why not give a course on Gödel incompleteness theorems? Please observe that this course is mainly for our students of the MSc in mathematics and applications. And in the bachelor degree in math in our department, there is a course on mathematical logic. And in that course, we give the incompleteness theorems. And that's the reason we are not considering them in this course. And on the other hand, of course, the incompleteness theorems are negative. So somehow people become, oh, in the end, this does not work. So we are giving positive examples. And we should refer that the theory of real order, real closed ordered fields is actually an example of a very successful theory. Even people from electrical engineering have heard about real closed ordered fields. So that's the contribution for something which is a positive result, a useful result.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Okay, so thank you very much for the presentation. And we are looking forward now to questions. Mm-hmm. Questions about the book mainly. Mm-hmm. I think there can be any other questions.
So there is also a question about category theory. I'm always a sympathizer of category theory, but later on I'm not using category theories anymore. Why? Because if you write a paper on category theory nowadays, they will ask, why category theories? We have to learn a lot in order to understand the paper, and people don't have the time to do so. But actually, in this course, we talk about categories a bit because precisely of the quantifier elimination. And so we give the notion of what is a category and provide some examples, and also what is a functor, what is a natural transformation, and then what is an adjunction. And we actually prove two or three examples about that. But it's, of course, a very small modicum. Okay, just to remember that there is category theory and to let the students know that there is category theory.
Okay, I understand that you asked this question especially for me to hear the answer. Because I'm completely still crazy about category theory.
Yeah, true.
It's my
but you must recognize that a paper with category theory is not sometimes it's not very well understood, I would say.
Yeah, because I think we still have to work out better ways to present category theory to people.
Yeah, true.
But I have two very small questions. Do you have exercises or problems in your book?
Yes.
Yes, throughout the book, we have exercises that are together in the book with when it is relevant, when to prove certain auxiliary results, and then more deep exercises at the end, usually. So we have exercises throughout the book.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Okay, this is very important aspect for any book, you know, because I think the only way to learn something is through your own work.
Yeah.
Then I have another, maybe this is completely unrelated, but it's just a curiosity. On the page 8 of your presentation,
page 8,
there is a bibliography. There is a bibliography, and there is one item there. There is an author in that item, R. Pollack. So I think.
So you are referring to the Bazu book?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Long time ago, I met. There was a person called Randy Pollack, I think.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm not completely mistaken, in professor was in a group of Rod Burstall. Actually, he was a very close friend of Rod Burstall. I think he was programming the Lego system. It was a type theoretic system.
Right.
Designed by
but you think that it is the same?
Is it the same person? I cannot believe it.
So actually, Marie France Roy, for example, also has a very nice book on real algebraic geometry. And I think that this was an outgrowth of that. And basically, they give several algorithms because sometimes you do not need the full power, let's say, of real ordered closed fields, but just some types of sentence and so on, right? but I don't know, because Bazou is well known in this area. Marie Roy also, because she started with real algebraic geometry. About Polak,
because my understanding was that Randy Polak is the same person, was just a programmer.
Just a programmer.
He was a guy who was, had some difficulty to walk because he has a leg, some problem with the leg. I think I remember a very nice guy, you know, but I because it strike me, you know, this, the name.
But you know that in this book, Bazou, Polak, and so forth, they provide the algorithms and they also give their complexity. So I can understand that a person that knows about programming, providing that they know about complexity, is useful.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was all. Just that was mm-hmm. I'm curious, yes.
But anyway, actually, we don't cover algorithms in the course because there is no time, mm-hmm. right? But they are there. And we already use this book, actually. Because we did also some work on probability logic and so forth, and so we use this book in order to.
Our Polak from the book is not the same as Randy Polak. It's Richard Polak.
Okay.
Also, calling Randy Polak just a programmer is completely unfair. He's been doing a lot of very interesting work on coding and formalized proofs in systems like Edinburgh LF, etc. He was one of the first persons to actually put through some interesting non-trivial proofs in a fully mechanized way.
Okay. I didn't know very much about, just I met him and he was a very nice person. So I,
And apart from,
well, just
from
curious
everything, he was for the name, a very nice person, but that's another story. Yeah.
So, maybe next question.
May I ask a question?
Yes, please. Go ahead.
We are not hearing, sorry.
Because I think he has to unmute.
Yeah, he has to unmute, right.
In the meanwhile, I can ask a question, maybe. I would. I was wondering if you have any results on, if all the results are based, if the first order logics are all classically based, or if you have some results on other more general results on
what do you mean with
some classic with intuitionistic or some
no this is just a first order logic
classical based
yes
thank you
definitely so
okay thank you
so I think Professor Goncharov has not unmuted yet. So, Professor Goncharov, if you hear me, I think you have to unmute, to press a button to unmute, otherwise we cannot hear you.
We cannot hear you, yeah.
Right.
Okay.
Okay, it's work now.
Yeah, so now
there is in model theory some approach connected with decidable models, and if we have decidable model, in this case we have some decidable presentation of this model. But what about with a case with the elimination quantifier? What about complexity? Is it possible to construct it some models with polynomial complexity?
That we don't, we don't analyze such, I mean, we do not deal with any complexity issues here.
In last year, it was proved that for exactly real closed field and for algebraic field, it's possible to construct it polynomial presentation exactly.
That's precisely one of the topics that Bazou, Polak, and Mary-France Roy deal with. But we do not tackle anything related with complexity. So we don't focus so much on the algorithms and so forth for the theories that we prove to be decidable.
Mm-hmm. Yes, but okay. Yes, but very natural to consider exactly decidable models.
Right, right.
In true. This case.
True.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
So I think we have time for other questions. So I don't know. Is there no other questions? Perhaps we
I can ask a question out of curiosity. I still didn't read the book. Just, do you focus, like you said, the electrical engineers use a lot the algebraic closed fields in robotics, actually. The fastest algorithm is made
by the... So they know about...
I don't know if they
know what is decidability, but they have the...
They have the best, algorithm.
Was designed by, theory.
The best algorithm is the binary electrical engineer, actually, which is impressive. They use it in robotics to solve some systems that we know. The question is, do you actually point any applications of decidability? Because it could be used to a lot of things like, verification, thinking in context traceability, or just focus on the theory and not...
No, we just, unhappily, we just focus on the theories and general techniques for proving decidability.
Okay, thank you so much.
Because as we said, this was intended to be a course, let's say an MSc course, basically, right?
I just was trying to sell them to the engineers.
It's not so easy. I think that, for example, a book on temporal logic and model checking is, of course, very much appreciated by the engineers and much more appreciated by the engineers.
Again, a decidable logic, right?
So. Yeah, true.
So these are other decidable logics.
True.
But for electrical engineers, they want more than temporal logics.
They want more, right.
A bit more.
But they, as I said, they know about, and of course, they also know several things about propositional logic, SAT problem, even Presburger arithmetic. They know about Presburger arithmetic.
Yeah, I was in shock with this kind of discovery.
Because I don't know if it is your impression, but actually electrical engineers, I would say that are more knowledgeable about mathematical stuff. That's for sure.
The shocking is that our colleagues from geometry don't know. That's the shocking part.
I think there are some, I know at least two examples of electrical engineers that later on in life became very strong mathematicians. Mm-hmm. I think one is István Nemeti from Budapest. And another one was a former director of my institute, Institute of Mathematics, was a model theorist, applying model theory in algebra. And both these people had a degree in electrical engineering.
But they changed afterwards, or they did something in electrical engineering after the degree?
No. I think István Nemeti, I think he did not did any other degree. But he just switched gradually to mathematics, and actually to very abstract mathematics. Mm-hmm. He was in Andrei Kanemeti, important figure in categorical model theory in algebraic logic. Mm-hmm. It's giant figures. And but his wife was a mathematician by education. And in the case of my director, my former director, he did another degree in mathematics at the age of almost 40 or something like this.
Mm-hmm. That was quite usual in Portugal for people from electrical engineering to end up as mathematicians. Nowadays, that's not the case. It's
Yeah. Yes, I think if there is there are no more questions, I think it was a very nice up to my evaluation, my understanding, it was a very nice seminar.
Okay, thank you very much for the invitation. It was a real pleasure to be here with you.
Yes, yes. I hope we can continue this webinar. So when is the next one?
The next session is next week at the same time. We have two sessions per month. And the next one is September 15, and it will be on the Liar Paradox. So everybody is welcome to join.